Hello, I'm Steve Sedgwick, and a warm welcome to CNBC's Internet of Things, powering the digital economy debate. The debate today is about sustainable resilience, and a whole host of key talking points will come up in our conversation, including how COVID can actually act as a catalyst for a global reset and accelerate digital transformation. We want to know how businesses have adopted and accelerated their digital transformation. Which technologies are going to be absolutely key? Is it going to be IoT, 5G, AI, automation? All of the above, I'm sure, will come up in our conversation. But it's also about resilience as well, and creating future-proof companies that are flexible and can operate in diverse situations. We also want to know about the employee as well. What has this done to workforces as well? What has it done to occupancy management of the businesses they've left behind in their traditional workplaces as well? Now, later on, I'm going to be joined by a great panel of guests to debate these topics. But first, I'm delighted to say we are joined now by the chairman and CEO of Schneider Electric. That's Jean-Pascal Tricoire, and together we will set the scene for our debate. Now, Jean-Pascal, it's a real pleasure to see you today, and I know for a fact, of course, you held your virtual innovation summit in early October, where a whole host of the issues that we've already mentioned did come up, the challenges and which technologies will be key going forward, where we are on the technology as well. But first of all, very easy question for you, Jean-Pascal. What was your key message for that conference?
Yeah, well, the key message was about what we've learned from this very special period of COVID-19 and on what is ahead of us on bigger challenges that we shouldn't lose of sight. For us at Schneider, we are specialized on developing technology, digital solutions for sustainability, and we still see climate change as the biggest challenge that we have to face. But at the end of the day, would it be COVID-19 or would it be sustainability? All of this is accelerating the need for digital and digitization. What we've learned in the past months is what is digital does work. I mean, we can communicate even if we can't travel. We can collaborate even if we are not in the same office. And we can, for many of our customers, keep on going because we can remote operate installations because they are connected and digitized. So, the past months have been a massive acceleration of digital adoption, and at Schneider, we see it also as a massive catalyzer for better sustainability.
Look, it's no doubt about it. The businesses have survived and appear to be thriving despite everything being thrown at them. But I want to make this very personal, if I may, on my second question. What have you personally learned from this about the way that business can be run, about the way that Schneider goes forward? Because you have been someone who I've spoken to for many years. There's no doubt about it. You're forward thinking. You buy into many of the key issues of the day. But what have you personally learned?
Well, I think we are still learning, Steve. From that point of view, I can't say I like the characteristics of the time, but the fact that it lasts long means that we have really to reinvent many of the ways we are operating. But what we are learning is first is that the large majority of the business we do, we are a global company, but the vast majority of what we do is local. So as we organize with local teams, fundamentally, the business keeps going. The second point is that supply chains have recovered really fast, and goods are still traveling. Goods are still circulating from one place to the other one, and they've recovered very, very, very fast. And the third point is that people who are traveling, executives or people who are going for scrum teams in R&D, well, have learned to work on video. On from home, on from remote. And that has been possible because we had digital tools to make it possible. But if you consider that business is local, that at the end of the day, goods are circulating, and that we can collaborate, reinventing the way we work together, then the business is back on, and we are working almost normally. Now, what we've learned also is that things recover better and faster where there is a very strong trust between companies, between their ecosystem around them, their suppliers, their integrators, and a very strong connection between local communities and government and companies, because we had to face a lot of unprecedented situations, very different from one place to the other one. every country, every community reacts in a different manner. So being very local and very intertwined locally is really important.
Now, look, I know that you've got some big technologies either in the market now or coming to market next year. Breakers, low-voltage switchboard, and my favourite word in the world, eco-structure, the automation expert that's going to help companies there as well. But where are we missing the technologies in this new digitised world? Where do we need to see the greatest leaps forward?
Frankly, I don't think we miss technology. The problem is not technology anymore. The problem is adoption. When you look at the whole equation of climate change and reconciling progress on sustainability for all, making sure that everybody gets access to energy, but at the same time, we cut the carbon emission by a factor of two. It means digitizing everything we live and work with for more efficiency to start with. It means much more circular economy, which is massively enabled by digital. And it means more electricity and decarbonized electricity. So, all of those technologies do exist. There is nothing big and massive and things to invent that would condition the success of all of this. But what we need to change is the way we design and architect our buildings, the way we design our manufacturing, the way we rethink things because of digital. And all of this asks us really to work together to train generations of technicians and designers to those new disciplines. But today I would say problem is not technology and innovation, problem is adoption. And we are just at the beginning. I always say that, but internet modified the way we live and work together, people to people, in the past 20 years. And clearly life today is very different from what it was 20 years ago. The Internet of Things is barely starting. So we have to change the way we live with our environment as much as we did with the Internet of People in the next 20 years to come. So it's just really the beginning of a big revolution, and it's more about adoption than anything else.
Sure. And what is fascinating is you and I have had this conversation on many aspects of it many times about IoT, digitalization, 5G. But what we didn't perhaps see coming is this adoption of it at a widespread domestic level. We're all in our homes now. You're in Hong Kong, I'm in London. I could be at my home in Sussex now and have this same conversation. Has your policy, has your focus changed? Because you had a big focus on retrofitting buildings, for instance. Are we going to need those office buildings anymore?
Well, I believe you're going to need office buildings, you're going to need different spaces. They're going to have to be flexible, they're going to have to be very human-centric. There will be new needs in buildings. We are really working a lot on repurposing the technology to make buildings healthier, check the air circulation, check the air quality, check the density of people on the floor space. So everything exists to make it happen, but this need for more resiliency, more healthy spaces on the top of efficiency and sustainability is today increasing. So yes, we're gonna need those buildings, we're going to need homes. I see many people who have been locked down in their home for, let's say, a few months, have plenty of ideas of things that should be different in their homes, and we see that in ourselves at Schneider. But we have to, after this COVID time, rethink and repurpose those technologies to better serve the new needs.
I can't remember how many years, I think it's 5 years ago, you and I were at Le Bourget for COP21 as well. We're both pretty passionate about climate and sustainability and the move for more environmentally friendly ways of doing business. Has some of that been put back by our focus on COVID-19, by the vast amount of money that's being spent on COVID-19, rather than this dual aim of digitizing and actually creating a better world in terms of our climate initiatives?
I don't think so. I think it's good that you speak about the COP21, because it was really a turning point. It was a turning point when the debate went from politics and NGOs to companies and cities. If you want to be attractive for both a company and a city, you've got to be sustainable. And you've got to be digital, by the way, too. So we've seen that turning point at that moment. And this was accelerated a few years ago by a tipping point at the level of investors. Investors being massively more demanding on the ESG program of every company. Now, look back at what happened in the past 9 months on that, those times of COVID. One could have said, okay, people will focus on the COVID on forget about sustainability. I would dare to say just the contrary. I think even it's not completely a direct correlation, but many people have understood that behind the COVID and climate change, you have the same sorts of root causes, density of population, urbanization, sometimes also a little bit of globalization, but I would say the two first factors coming really ahead of the three. And it reminds us that nature can block our society with viruses, but tomorrow the biggest thing will be climate change with much heavier consequences. So what we see today is an acceleration of the sustainability agenda for the voters, for the people, for companies. You see really more people going into a trajectory of 1.5 degree, and for cities, which are really looking at their attractiveness, pollution, the ecology vote. So all of this is going to the same direction. I would say, and I believe we've always said it, or I've always said it, that smart digital is the best foundation for sustainability. And those two are accelerating and have really accelerated in 2020.
And let me just go back into one of your key new products as well, the EcoStruxure Automation Expert. And I thought about this, it looks great. You're going to free up engineers to do all the exciting stuff as well. Is that actually what's going to happen? Are those engineers still going to be there as well? I think the AI and all these new tools, it's going to take jobs away, isn't it, potentially?
I don't think so. I think it's going to change the nature of job. We've always seen digitization at the service of people, not in replacement of people. And think about it, if you can give operators on the shop floor augmented reality tools, tablets that say, well, this problem or that problem is occurring before they can open a machine and be at risk, you not only improve efficiency, but more so you improve their safety.
Let's go right back to where we started, if we can, and just kind of round off the conversation with, let's face it, the clear and present danger, which is COVID-19 as well. The longevity of this crisis has gone on, but the speed of pharmaceutical innovation and hopes for the vaccine, that's built up a pace. But how quickly do we need to see an end of this phase of the crisis and bringing in of these vaccines so that people can get back to a degree of normality, albeit in a more digitized world? Is it important in order to move forward that we see the end of COVID-19?
Of course, the sooner the better, and especially to have solutions that all of the countries will trust so that we reestablish a level of circulation in the world. That would be important for all. But at the same time, we have no choice. We have to live with the present constraints, and let's make sure that as it lasts for a long time, that we learn to do things differently. And we get rid of all the unnecessary travel that we had before, on many of the things we used to do in a traditional manner, and do it on leverage digital and other capabilities to do things different, and be better. That will be better for our health, for our balance, for our work-life balance, and that will be better for the carbon footprint of the planet. And I see a lot of attitudes which have moved during the crisis. For instance, we used to have multiple meetings with the customers when we had to commission equipment. And now we did that through camera, directly from the factory to their office. There is no resistance to do it, because we have all accepted that it was actually very acceptable now. Connectivity is becoming much more acceptable to our customers on a large scale. So those changes, let's not forget, and let's learn for the future to have a way of working that will be a hybrid between where we are before and what we've learned during this period. But the sooner we exit this period, the better, of course.
Jean-Pascal, thank you very much indeed for everything. I've noticed it's getting dark behind you, so you have your evening ahead in Hong Kong. Thank you very much indeed, and it's been a real pleasure speaking to you once again. Jean-Pascal Tricoire, the Schneider Electric Chairman and CEO.
Looking forward to speaking to you soon.
Well, a great panel of guests is just about to join me, but before I introduce them, here's a short film to add some context and frame the debate.
we are facing one of the biggest challenges of our lifetime. We have changed how we live our daily lives, how we work with each other, and how we operate as a society. Globally, the severity and scale of the COVID-19 pandemic continues to test the resiliency and agility of organisations across all sectors. In this period of disruption, leaders have unexpectedly and swiftly adapted business models and developed new strategies in order to both survive and prosper. Companies have had to accelerate their adoption and adaption of digital technologies, putting long-term plans into action within a matter of months.
What's happened with COVID is it's accelerated what might have taken us, 2 years to achieve down to a couple of weeks. Businesses need to go digital. This entire pandemic is kind of putting that in very stark light.
So what key role will digital technologies such as IoT, 5G and automation play in building resiliency and ensuring business continuity now and in the future? And how can these technologies enable remote management of entire business operations using real-time data to adapt at speed?
Prior to this crisis, we were unable to hire enough workers, and so we're investing in automation. Automation will change the face of the employment landscape, no doubt.
As our working world becomes increasingly remote, how can cybersecurity best protect business systems and operations?
Cybersecurity company Checkpoint has recently reported that they have seen around 200,000 coronavirus-related cyber attacks just in the last couple of weeks.
What role will this accelerated digital transformation play in optimizing energy and operational efficiencies in order to create a more sustainable working world? As we prepare for this new digital age, one thing is certain. Businesses will need to adopt the right technologies in order to be flexible and thrive in these unprecedented times. Welcome to CNBC's IoT Powering the Digital Economy debate as we look to a future of sustainable resilience.
Well, joining us today is Daniel Julian, who is the chairman and CEO of Teleperformance. Bev White joins us, the chief executive of the Harvey Nash Group as well, who's done a lot of work on what technology is doing to the workforce as well. An old friend of mine, Mats Granrid, who is the director general of the GSMA. And I'm delighted to say hello for the first time to Edward Wagoner as well, who is the chief information officer at JLL Technologies as well. Well, look, thank you all for joining me today on what will be hopefully a very stimulating debate as well. So let me take a step back. We've gone through a year which many people want to forget, 2020, but I think there's some good that can potentially come out of this. Certainly there is technological change that is coming out of it and acceleration of that as well. But just thinking about where we are now compared to where we would have been 10 years ago, we couldn't have coped, I don't believe, 10 years ago as well. So how are we doing? Daniel, let's start off with you. You're working for a company, you run a company that I think had under 10,000 work from home employees at one point, and then you went to over 200,000 in 6 weeks. That is incredible, Daniel.
Yeah, in fact, we were surprised by the COVID, but at the same time, we had already the technology and the process in place. So it was much more two things. First, to remove the psychological barrier to move from brick and mortar to work at home. And second, it was a big logistic task. But we did it. And for us, it has been the first element of our resilience because we had a very DV curve. And I would say after less than 2 months, the company was growing again at the same organic path as pre-COVID.
Bev, you've been in the business of IT recruitment and specialized services for that sector for a very, very long time as well. Have you ever seen anything that is such a stratospheric change in the way people do work and how people coped?
No, I haven't seen anyone, any organisation have to go through something as fast as this. And it's been phenomenal. I think many organisations have been super surprised at how quickly they've adapted. I think really the big challenge hasn't really been the technology. There has been some, but it hasn't been that. It's about people and keeping people connected and motivated, not feeling alone, because we're not all fortunate to have, you know, spaces we can work from separate to the rest of the household at home.
That's very interesting. We'll come on to a lot about the interaction between people and machines as well, because it's a source of anxiety. But Mats, in terms of the technology we have here, I made a very bold statement. I said we couldn't have got to where we are today in terms of coping with COVID-19 with 10 years ago technology. Is there any accuracy in that statement?
No, I think it is, Steve, and I especially enjoyed what Bev said, that it's not a technological issue. And I think we, from the mobile industry, take some pride in the fact that the networks have been resilient, despite the fact that voice calls has tripled, despite the fact that data usage has doubled in many cases. But not only that, the areas where we're using the data has changed from office environment to my home. And I think we have captured and we have coped okay. We're not brilliant, but we are okay. But what I do see is, and I do think as well, that the time is right. It was sort of okay now because we were on the implementation of 4G, which is becoming a very mature technology. And 5G is just about to being launched in many different markets. So we have a mature, stable technology that we can use. If this would have been another couple of years out in time, we would be sort of more into 5G, which would be a little bit more complicated, I think. So from that perspective, the pandemic, you know, if we're going to have one, why not have it now, maybe?
And that's very interesting. And I know there are big questions about the adoption of 5G going forward. And of course, because 5G is all about mobility. It's about giving us first-rate connectivity on the go. But of course, most of us, Edward, as we're seeing now, we're stuck at home. We're in our kitchen. I believe you are in your kitchen, actually, Edward, as well. So the point I want to raise to you, Edward, is the other three guests on this panel, whether it's 5G, whether it's helpline of helplines, whether it's IT recruitment, that will go on regardless. But the future of the workplace, that is really in doubt. What is the workplace going forward? That must have been a meteoric shift for JAL Technologies.
Oh, it's a great question. The workplace was already evolving. What COVID did for us is it accelerated the trends. So we're seeing that people will want more flexibility. You're right, I'm in my kitchen today because it's, I chose to be here. But tomorrow I may choose to go into the office. So we're seeing through our research, people still want the flexibility to go into the office. They just want to be safe and they want to have a better experience. That'll be the trend that we'll see going forward post-COVID that will work into our workplace strategies.
And then the fact that I can act as a TV anchor at home in East Sussex and you all can talk to me from around the world. It's quite staggering that we can do this with the level of technology we're at. But the main topic of this conversation today is about our resilience as well. So I want to just go straight into that in our second round of questioning. And I want to know how resilient you all feel we are in your various skill sets and your various businesses as well. Because Daniel, how resilient is your business now with those 200,000 plus workers, maybe even more than that now, working from home? They're using their own devices in many ways. They're subject to potentially the same challenges that you would have in a single workplace, but now they've got them in over 200,000 workplaces as well. Do you feel more resilient?
Yeah, the business is doing for us amazingly well. I mean, our growth has never been so fast than today. And this comes from the explosion of the interaction created by the development of all the e-solution, e-commerce, e-entertainment, e-learning, and so on. And so the customer want to interact, they interact via many channels. And as we are the global leader in the outsourcing, managing the customer experience, in fact, the business is doing very well. But for us, what we have done, we have gone one step further. We have developed a very stable TP, what we call teleperformance cloud solution, where everything is virtual with all the stable process. I mean, hiring, training, coaching, managing, controlling, putting a lot of IT solution to ensure data security. So our business is great.
But it feels different, doesn't it? When I was on the phone to, actually, Mats, you're like this. I was on the phone to my my mobile operator because I'm near the end of my contract and I was looking at which phone I get next or which mini computer it is, because they're not really phones, are they? And I could tell that the gentleman I was speaking to was at home. I could tell the lady he put me onto in the retention unit that she was at home somewhere as well. It does feel a little bit different, the product offering, doesn't it, Daniel?
Yeah, but at the same time, what is important is, first, to be able to answer your question, your rational questions, and that's why we use a lot of robotic process automation, but also what is important, and specifically in these COVID times that are generating a lot of anxiety, is to be a human link. And the fact that our people are at home, that from time to time you can hear the dog, is okay. People are happy with that, because people feel that there is a link. The socialization continues. And I think that on both sides, the customer, but also the employees, everybody is going to benefit from that. And today in the US, we know that almost 50% of the people, they want to be able to continue to work from home, even post-COVID.
But Bev, do people feel that actually that they feel more resilient now as well? Because I find that very hard to believe, because you're in a people business as well. And people are spread out, and we are, dare I say, even me, social animals as well. Being all split up and having your IT person down in Cornwall, which is true, my IT person at CNBC is down in Cornwall every other week as well. Me up in Sussex, my boss up in swanky West London as well. I don't feel necessarily that I'm part of the same team I was, as much as I still feel that everyone's working in a collegiate fashion, Bev.
You have to work harder at keeping people connected. I think that's really key. Communications has never been more important. Reaching out on a personal level, socially, as well as on a business footing, so that people feel that they're part of something bigger than, you know, their kitchen table and their immediate surroundings. I think, you know, we've talked about it already today. There will be a mix going forward, I think, of going to the office, going to perhaps a local hub where you can meet with others, perhaps not necessarily people you work with, just other people, and are working from home. And that, I think, that carries on. The thing to watch out for, of course, is mental health and well-being, really. And that's a growing issue, I think, for many organisations, to give people the support they need when at times you can feel overwhelmed and alone.
I couldn't agree more. And actually, let's just go straight there on the mental health issue as well, because I kind of touched on it with Jean-Pascal as well, about, well, what people feel about the job they're doing. And one thing he said to me is, well, a lot of the menial tasks will be done by the AI now. There will be a degree of automation and leaving engineers perhaps to do more creative work as well. But I do worry about the mental health as well. Edward, just coming to you before I come to Mats on this one as well. Have you thought about the role of the office? Because I'm kind of all of a sudden, and I guess we're all thinking now, what was the role of the office? Why did we cling to it so much? And I'm talking about white-collar work rather than industrial processes as well, but because I'm a white-collar worker, it makes me think. I've worked in the City of London for over 30 years. Now I'm wondering why, for a large portion of that, I bothered commuting, Edward.
So you want flexibility, and you said it yourself, and Bev talked about it. We come together to collaborate. We come together to be with other people like us. You even see now, even though some offices aren't open, people are still looking to get back out into the physical spaces. We've seen that all over the world. So as we think about, you know, the mental health of getting out and connecting in our offices, it's how do we connect with the people when they come in to give them that better experience, to allow them to see and interact with the environment that it's safe, that they are able to report issues. We're seeing upticks in people wanting to understand, when was this space last cleaned? And then also using technology to monitor utilization so that we can find hotspots. When we do that and people see us doing that, then they have confidence that we're putting their health and safety first. That gives them confidence as they come back into the workplace, and that helps with the mental health.
Let's jump in here. I started off in resilience. We moved to mental health very quickly. We talked about the office. We can add in 5G into the same conversation as well. But is 5G almost, dare I say, a link technology between the home workplace and the physical workplace?
Oh, I don't think so. I think we are physical animals that enjoy social interaction, and innovation and creativity is certainly today taking a toll, I believe. I think we absolutely need to find new ways of collaborating. We need to either, if not go back to the office, at least have some sort of hub where we can meet up people. I've had within GSMA, my staff say, Mats, we just need to have one day in office or at least some sort of controlled measure to get back, because we're starving. We're sitting at home and not being able to do our task properly. It's fine when you're following up on a project or you know type of more repetitive activities, but when you want to be creative and innovative, you need to see people. Creating new business, you need to see people. You can't do that over phone.
Okay, well, I started off by talking about resilience. Let's talk about limitations as well, because I feel almost this is one of the final points we should come to, but I'm fascinated. So what are the limitations of all these amazing technologies? And I think we've obviously touched on one. It cannot replicate society. It cannot sort out our need for companionship and indeed sort out some of the mental health issues as well. So limitations of the technology amidst the crisis we're going through. Bev, I can see you nodding as well. What are the limitations?
Sure. I think Matt's just talked about innovation. So, you know, think about when you're in the midst of a really engaging conversation about something new, an area that you've not yet developed. You know, it's noisy, it's a little bit messy, it's not structured. These kind of conversations we're having today are very focused, structured, polite. And so it's hard to create that using the technology. That would be one of the major ones for me.
And yet, Bev, I saw a Harvey Nash Group survey, and it was a survey of IT leadership, that was it, and 71% of the respondents planned to increase the use of automation for service, dealing with various issues and what have you. That's less jobs, that's less cohabitation, that's less collaboration as well. I worry a little bit about us all going automated, Bev.
Different jobs, I'm not sure about less jobs. I think, you know, taking away the boring, repetitive, perhaps not so exciting work and giving, you know, the more interesting work to the human, I think is where we're talking about here. So automation to remove the less interesting roles. I think for sure there is more opportunities, I believe, for people in this new world, not less.
I want to say two things. Technology is a super help. Second, technology is not replacing the human being, because we are all human beings and we want a real conversation. But also what I want to say is that this virtual world in which we have been forced to plunge into has revealed to us a lot of possibilities that we were not exploiting. I can tell you, in my company, I interact every month with the top 20,000 managers. It's something that I never did before. And then we are in the budgeting process. We have meetings with 30, 50 managers, of course, with this collaborative platform. And it works super well, and sometimes much better than the usual bottom down or the opposite. Or the opposite that we use typically to work. Where I agree dramatically is creativity comes with human interaction and face-to-face interaction. The ability to move away from the frame defined by the technology.
I will get back to this and bring Mats and Edward into the physical versus the virtual and digital in a few moments' time. But there was a job that I saw, Bev, and when my days are over at CNBC, I quite like the idea of this one. Conversation specialist. What's a conversation specialist? Because I kind of quite like the idea of that, because I talk for England as well.
Well, you know, I think you could be in line for a great job in that role, so let me know when you're looking. But for sure, you know, this is a really good point, and a number of us have already said, you know, we are human beings that want to interact on a human level. And so as AI develops, you know, understanding how you can, you know, be more human in that automated process is part of it. So understand the dynamics of a conversation, but then also understanding when to hand it over. at what point, you know, do you say, actually, I've done the automated piece, I need to hand it over to a human being here now. Mm. So picking up and understanding through AI when that part of the process really needs to happen. So it's a combination of those effects.
Edward, what is the office going to offer that people can't get from home apart from collaboration and actually our need as a society to see each other? Because it seems to me that companies are not going to want to double up on their costs. If they are basically installing a lot of equipment at people's homes and that capacity as well, and giving them the ability to be at home, apart from our need for society to meet others as well, what is the office place going to actually offer as well? Because all I can see is a doubling up of costs, actually.
No, I think it's collaboration between people and attraction of talent. People want to be around other people that inspire them, that motivate them, feel like they have a place, that they're creating something. I also think in the conversation around chatbots and AI, we're already using experience apps. So I can talk to my mobile device in the office and say, I need to book a desk, and it can do that for me. Or I see an area that needs cleaning, and I can talk to it. I don't need to talk to a human. It can tell the work order system, which can tell the cleaning crew so that there's an immediate cleaning, and I can monitor all of that in real time. So the opportunities around technology to make us more efficient as we come back into the workplace and have that flexibility, I think that's where the true better use of space opportunities will be.
Do you believe that actually we'll ever reach the same kind of occupancy of office space and real estate that we had prior to the crisis, Edward?
You know, let's look back at history. And you started asking us about could we have done this 10 years ago? 10 years ago, 20 years ago, we would not be doing what we're doing right now. So we're in a continual evolution. People will want flexibility when we come back. All of us have talked about people wanting to be in the physical space. So there will be a place for the office. It will be different. It will be more collaborative. Our people are going to want to have better experiences. They're going to want to have choice. They're also going to want to know that we are taking their health and the health of the planet and the health of the buildings into account as we come back into these new reimagined workplaces.
I'm glad you brought the word collaborative up as well, because Matt, that's exactly where I wanted to go next. And I know it's one of the points which you and I have talked about, and indeed I think you want to get into this conversation as well. Collaboration as well. Now, we know that we're in a very tricky world politically, geopolitically as well. I don't want to talk about individual companies, and I don't want to talk about individual countries. I just want to get that on the record now as well. But I do worry about collaboration, Mats, as well. I worry about it at a technological level. We know there are trans-Pacific issues as well. We know there are people looking at different digital and technological standards as well. Do you worry and do you have grave concerns about policy collaboration, Mats?
Policies and technology harmonization is critically important for us to be able to drive scale and to be able to implement cost-effective solutions for us to use. So yes, that is of a concern. I think we need to be more collaborative going forward than what we have been in the past couple of years to achieve just that. And you know, the standardization of new technologies is equally really important, that is firm and that is being adhered to going forward.
Daniel, are you finding there are some places you can't put the same technology in or use the same providers for that technology? The hardware, you are finding it, you're nodding as well. Just give us an example of how tough you're finding it just having a seamless service globally when you've got potentially some of those challenges.
It's very simple. When it comes to data security, typically, you use predictive analytics, and you also use cameras to monitor the work environment. In some countries, you can do that without any issues. In some countries, it's totally forbidden by law, even if you are in a work environment. So definitely, you do not provide the same level of services to your client and to your customers in terms of fraud prevention.
Bev, security and privacy spending is going to go up, is going up as well. I think that was touched on by your survey as well. But again, Who are we securing ourselves and upping our privacy against? Do we know? Is it other companies? Is it individuals? Is it players who are looking to have cyber ransoms? Or is it, as I fear, on a country-by-country basis as well?
Yeah, it's going to be a combination of those. I think as we moved so quickly to working from home, we had to really very quickly get involved in terms of closing down the loopholes. And the attack levels have just continued to rise. I'm pretty certain we're not hearing nearly as much as what's really going on out there. So organizations, the top skill that is being sought for the first time in 10 years of us doing this survey is cyber skills. This is the most demanded skills anywhere in the world.
And Edward, upping the cloud component into the capability of the product offering you're giving out there, Edward, as well, it must add an extra cost basis, which again is the whole point about digitization technologies. It's taking your costs down as well. But at the moment, we're upping our costs on some of these key issues to make ourselves secure and safe, Edward.
But it's also leveraging, when we leverage the cloud, it gives us the ability to leverage the infrastructure. It gives us the ability to be more flexible. It gives us the ability to roll out some of these technologies faster, enable people to adopt them and use them in their new normal. I think too, from a cybersecurity perspective, if we take what we experience in our own lives and even with the mobile apps that we use in our personal lives, if I perceive that I'm getting a benefit from something, I'm more willing to share some of my information. And I think for a lot of people going forward, especially in the built environment, they're willing to share if they have confidence that you're using it effectively and if they see a benefit that they're getting back. So especially as we're starting to use IoT and experience apps, that's becoming more and more front and center from a cybersecurity perspective.
I've got a section here which is I've put in cryptically, size matters, and I think I know what I mean. And actually, Edward, I'll carry on with you on this one as well, because you pride yourself as a company on having very small companies and individuals who you provide services to, and to very large MNC, TNC type companies as well. Is there a digital divide, which I think, again, we'll touch upon something that Matt has been talking about as well, and we'll talk about here today. Is there a digital divide in terms of what companies can afford and what they're able to get from the new brave world, i.e. is it just down to money, or actually has this been, as the UK Prime Minister unfortunately called it at one point, the great leveler?
Well, I think if you look at just from a cost perspective, you could certainly get into that conversation. But when you factor in benefits, what is the benefit of creating a workplace where people can be collaborative, where they can feel healthy? And I think, too, the ability to collaborate between the big companies and the small companies, the lessons learned, and then the choices that you make for which technologies you use and which locations for which companies. Look, we've talked a lot about the office. There's a large part of our population that goes to work in manufacturing, as an example. They don't get to work from home. They need safe spaces. They need the ability to have technology to help them do their jobs better. So I think there is a huge opportunity in how we use this technology to be more effective and more efficient and to drive us into our next normal, where a lot of companies will have competitive advantage or see opportunities. Take the way that a lot of us change the way that we purchase goods and have them delivered. That's driving big changes for those companies that learn things about how they do their processes, how they make their deliveries. And right now they're making changes to both their operations and their real estate footprint to better deliver to their people as a result of what they learned through COVID. That's an opportunity.
Yeah, opportunity for sure. So and again, I'll ask you all very similar questions on this one as well. Does size prohibit you from getting the full benefits of digitization, of automation, of IoT, etc.? Or actually, is there some form of collaboration at an open source type level, which would have come through like a carousel office where you've got various companies working in a JA or a state building, what have you? Does the size of your company, the size of your balance sheet actually prohibit you? I know that sounds almost a disingenuous question, but if you can pull together, then the answer is not necessarily, Edward.
That's right. I think size, sometimes you can get some policies, you get people involved, you get some bureaucracy that can make things difficult, whereas smaller companies can make decisions to do some things faster, to pilot some things faster. Conversely, in larger companies, you've got numbers of people, you've got experiences, You've got collaborations maybe that the smaller companies can't do on their own. So I think there's pros and cons to both. I think one thing that we see is our ability to learn from our clients as we work with them, then share some of those learnings with other clients. That's how smaller companies or companies in other industries can benefit from companies like ours that have those experiences across the spectrum, across countries, across asset types.
I'll come to Mats on the digital divide and Daniel as well in a few moments' time. But Bev, I could see you nodding there as well. I mean, what are your thoughts on this one as well? Because training up a fully qualified IT consultant or someone, these are high-paid jobs as well. These are not minimum wage employees as well. I'd imagine they're very expensive for the smaller companies.
Yes, and this is where I think outsourcing is really starting to be on the rise again. As we know, you know, things go in circles, and what we're seeing now is that smaller organizations, as you said, you know, it's quite expensive to get your own skills, but to actually access them through another organization of scale and to provide you a secure platform that is done at speed, I think is really attractive for the smaller businesses. And really just picking up as well, I think Edward was talking about, you know, the kind of in the old world, perhaps the larger businesses might have taken longer, small businesses faster to act, the larger businesses slower. We're seeing that change a bit, and we're seeing much more collaboration now between business leaders and IT, you know, for the common good, especially where there is security at the heart of the issues that threaten an organization.
Daniel, I guess you're saying that Teleperformance does exactly this. It levels the playing field for big and small companies because you are, well, again, what was the phrase again? The helpline for helplines as well. It's for everyone, yeah?
Yeah. First, in what was said, there is something very important, which is the fact that data security is a must. The bad actors are very active, and the breach on data security are increasing. And it's a race that is never going to end, number one. Number two, security is first a question of culture. First, it starts with the people, then the right process, and then finally, the technology. Third, it's a new cost to be in business. Yes, technology reduces a lot of cost of being in business, but this is a new cost to be in business. For our company, it's in dozens of millions of euros every year. And we have 400 dedicated data security team doing just that. And I think just that outsourcing any kind of business will not exist without a stronger data security coming from the outsourcer. So an outsourcing company needs and must have a stronger, a higher level of data security.
Mats, I introduced this whole section talking about digital divide. I don't even know if this is where you wanted to go on digital divide as well. So just tell us what you feel are the issues here.
No, I think COVID-19 has done a lot of bad things. But one thing is, of course, to push the gap between the ones who have connectivity and the ones who have not connectivity. And as we know, this past year, we just passed 50% of the world's population being connected to the internet, and the vast majority through a mobile device. Now, There is two gaps of the remaining 50%. One is a coverage gap, i.e. there is no 3G or 4G network, and then there is a usage gap. The coverage gap is 650 million people that do not have any means of connecting to the internet. But actually the usage gap is five times bigger. And so it's a 3.3 billion people that lives beneath a mobile broadband network, i.e. a 3G or a 4G network, but they choose not to use the device for various reasons. It's costs, affordability, it is stigma, it is I don't know how to use the device, etc. And there is also, I would argue, maybe the biggest thing is that there is nothing there for me. There's no relevant content. So I am, if you ask me about size matters, I am more concerned that we are in this COVID crisis pushing the gap further and harder. So this split, the divide between us being digital literate and being part of this new digital economy, we will sort of be okay. But you have a huge portion of people, half the world's population at least, and this is not just in low and middle income countries, this is as much in developed high earning countries as well, that are not going to be part of this new digital economy. So I think we need to think long and hard, how do we make sure that people use the internet, feel comfortable of using the internet? And I think I would then refer back to what Daniel said around safety and security, which is really, really important to get that right, so people feel comfortable of using the device. And there is so many studies linking a high degree of usage, high degree of connectivity to economic prosperity and a happier society, if you will.
Mats, will the money be available? I look at the global debt pile at a sovereign corporation at a personal level, and I am horrified. I am terrified as well. So will the money be able to be there when we need it, which we need it now and beyond, in order to bridge that gap?
Well, I mean, if you look at the CapEx investments that this industry are planning to do for the coming 5 years, roughly $1.1 trillion. $1.1 trillion in 5 years. 80% of that will be towards 5G. So the money is there. The interest to build out the next generation of networks is absolutely there. And I think what Edward said initially about us developing, we're on a continuous journey as humans. I think that is such an unstoppable force. And technology is there to support us to take the next step in this evolution.
Is education keeping up with technological change? Is the education establishments, I mean, I look at my own examples and looking in the United Kingdom, and I do have questions whether it's the employer or the schools and the universities that should be doing the hard miles on this one. Do you have a strong view, Bev?
I do. I think for sure we need to put devices in the hands of the many and not the few, for starters. So we can all look to examples of where schooling had to go home and families have one device between a number of children. It was difficult. I think the second thing is we as employers and organisations need to get more involved in schooling system to help the schools understand what is relevant in terms of teaching new skills and preparing young people for the future.
Right, okay, look, I'm painfully aware that we have about 5 minutes left and I have two rounds of questions for you. So actually one question I wanted to ask you all, because we talk about digital, we talk about the Internet of Things and technology, we talk about it with the COVID backdrop, but we haven't talked about it with the other great issues of our times backdrop as well. The fact that we are all improving on ESG as well, hopefully at least we're on a journey. The fact that we are doing this amidst great concern about climate change as well, and where we go next on that as well. So if you can frame it, how you see this development, but within the broader issues as well, the broader issues of how we can do this hand in hand with ESG, how we can do it hand in hand with actually making a meaningful impact in climate as well. Edward, I'm going to start off with you.
Sure, and I think, you know, it's a great question. The built environment produces a substantial amount of our greenhouse gases, so we know we have a responsibility to do things better, to be more responsible. One way to do that is leveraging IoT. If I can monitor utilization in a building, then I can decrease energy consumption. If I can use IoT to monitor, for example, water usage, especially where we have some of the water systems shut down right now in offices, then I know which ones have been used and which ones I need to flush to get the potential pathogens out of the system. Those types of technologies actually make us more efficient, but they also make us create more sustainable environments for our people. And I think the last one too is around health. As we use IoT to monitor traffic patterns or how people are using the space, we can help the planet be healthier, but we can also help our people be healthier. And I think those are some great opportunities. The technology was there pre-COVID. It's accelerated post-COVID. A lot of people have moved from that's a nice to have to that's a must have for me, both COVID and what we're seeing going on in the world around us.
Mats, how important are these issues hand in hand for the GSMA?
are very important, not only for GSMA, but for the whole mobile and tech industry, as I think Edward was saying. I think we see an enablement effect, if you would like, where you deploy technology, you deploy it wisely, and you can save 10 times the pollution that you would do initially. So certainly there is a lot of good things that we can do. But I also think that in this day and age, sustainable leadership is really important. Ethical leadership, where we go back to the triple bottom line idea. And I think I see more and more of that, where you are talking about profit. Well, that's for sure. We need to make money. But the people dimension is becoming, and you Stephen spoke about mental health. The people dimension is critically important. And then the last P, which is the planet dimension. Climate is really at the forefront right now, and it's critically important that we continue to push the climate and the people dimension and profit, obviously, for us to make sure that we are sustainable in the way we do business.
And we're lucky to have two CEOs just sitting underneath you in terms of my screen I can see here now who are going to answer that as well. Bev, let me just start off with you on this one as well. I hear a lot this year. In fact, I heard it from World Economic Forum only a couple of weeks ago. It's about stakeholders, not shareholders now, Bev.
I completely agree with that. You know, it's music to my ears as well, hearing about, you know, sustainable leadership and ethical leadership here. There's never been a more important time. You know, people in our organizations are looking to leaders and trusting them that they will make decisions that are good for them, for them as people, for the organization, and for the communities and, you know, surrounding environments we work in. So I think that's an essential element. I think also the second part, you know, the technology part, which is, you know, the drive towards more cloud-based services. The very large, the hyperscale cloud providers have very ambitious net zero goals. And actually, that's got to be good for the environment overall. So I'm optimistic.
And Daniel, you are, of course, now one of the biggest 40 companies in France in terms of CAC 40 exposure as well. Do your stakeholders and shareholders have common goals and aims going forward? Is it about digitization, but understanding the human and planetary cost?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, our shareholder base, by the way, is mostly Anglo-Saxon, coming either from the US or from the UK. And I can tell you that the social responsibility is part of our governance. Now, there is something that to me is very simple, COVID or no COVID. Right now, the world population grow more or less by 100 million people, individual, every single year. And these people, these individuals, they want to have a kind of life that looks like more or less the life of the very developed countries. It's not sustainable as it is today. And clearly, right now, the virtual world, at least, there is less traffic jam, there is less time loss in transportation, it's better for the planet, there is less pollution, it's maybe better for the people because they have more quality time, but it's clear that the way the human beings are going to organize themselves to be able to live with 8 billion people very soon, when 50 years ago, it was half of that. 50 years ago, it was just half of that, is the key equation. And so technology is going to help. Profits need to exist for the organization to be able to continue to invest, grow, and do a positive job for the human being and for the planet. But the politics and each individual citizen have to understand that we have a little planet called Earth that has high fever, global warming, and that a lot of decisions that have been taken but never implemented should be implemented.
Thank you, Daniel. I think I should let you go in a minute, but I'm going to ask you one very easy question each first. I'm going to do it in reverse order as well. And that is which technology is going to serve our resilience best amidst COVID-19, after COVID-19 and going forward as well? So we'll start off with Edward. We'll move on to Matt, the Bev, and then we'll finish off with Daniel. So Edward, which technology are you setting your stall out with?
You know, there's so many technologies that we could talk about, but I think I'm going to answer in a different way. It's the people that are the most important. If I think about, I've made my living in real estate and with technology, people are still number one. So everything that we do needs not to be for technology's sake, but how does it help our people be more efficient? How does it help them be safer? How does it help them have flexibility? To that end, I think the technologies that help people understand how they can be more productive, help them interact with the space better. Those are going to be the technologies that we focus on. Those are going to be the technologies that we help our clients with. Those will be the technologies that people will embrace and will use.
Matt, is it possible I know which technology you're going to tell us?
Yeah, well, I like Edward's answer on people, but I would say intelligent connectivity will be a major factor going forward. And that's actually four different components. It's 5G, obviously. It is IoT, it's AI, and it's big data. If you put those four components into one bucket, you call it intelligent connectivity, and you deploy that wisely with ethical leadership, we're going to be in a fantastic position.
Bev, they're very broad answers from the two gentlemen so far. Are you going to laser-like focus on one area, or are you going to carry on that thematic?
No pressure then. I would say, for sure. I mean, you know, I work in a people industry. However, I think AI and robotics, you know, supporting people in their working lives, you know, to make life more enjoyable or interesting. And I think, you know, to achieve more with those, I think is where I see the growth.
Thank you, Bev. And Daniel, finally.
Right now, on the day-to-day, it's the collaborative platform. Because yes, the most important are the people, and what makes the life of the people easier on the day-to-day is the fact that we are able to collaborate.
Perfect. In fact, two of your answers, Bev and gentlemen, intelligent connectivity and collaborative platform, it could be a metaphor for this wonderful conversation. We've covered an awful lot of ground as well, from resilience to collaboration to bridging data and digital divides globally as well. What's going to happen on a geopolitical level? The workplace, of course, so important. We've had great contributions from Edward and all of you on that as well. Education, where the responsibility lies. Easy question, which technology? And of course, where our digitization and resilience debate fits in to the broader global challenges as well. I want to thank all of you very much indeed for joining us today. So that's Daniel Julian, who is the chairman and chief executive of Teleperformance, Bev White, the chief executive of Harvey Nash Group, Mats Granred, director general of GSMA, and Edward Wagoner, the chief information officer at JLL Technologies. Thank you all very much indeed again for what I believe has been intelligent connectivity. That's it, and thank you very much indeed.